Charles Neer is widely credited with describing the anterior-superior glenohumeral space between the subscapularis and supraspinatus tendons. It is bounded superiorly by the supraspinatus, the subscapularis inferiorly, and the coracoid process forms its medial base. Contained within this triangular space is the coracohumeral, middle glenohumeral, and superior glenohumeral ligaments, the long head of the biceps tendon, and the anterior joint capsule. The configuration of these structures and foramen within the rotator interval exhibit considerable variability. The function of the structures within the rotator interval are the subject of multiple in vivo and in vitro biomechanical studies, and many of these are contrasting. Harriman and colleagues classically reported one of the first cadaveric studies examining the function of rotator interval structures. The authors conclude that the interval functions as a check rein against excessive motion by limiting posterior and inferior glenohumeral translation. Clinical studies citing altered motion with interval closure also supports this proposed function, though the magnitude and direction of restriction is still debated. Rotator interval structures also contribute to the stability of the long head of the biceps tendon by forming the reflection pulley. This supports the bicipital tendon as it exits the glenohumeral joint. Arthroscopic and open procedures have been described to imbricate rotator interval tissues. The results of open coracohumeral imbrication by Harriman and colleagues are often extrapolated to arthroscopic closures despite fundamental differences in the interval closure technique. This has resulted in an interesting controversy regarding the true function of, and indication for, a rotator interval closure. The typical arthroscopic superior glenohumeral ligament to middle glenohumeral ligament closure more closely depicts closure of the subscapularis foramen. Recent analysis of this technique by Provencher and others has failed to replicate Harriman's results. Recently, Farber and colleagues compared a medial to lateral arthroscopic technique using suture anchors with a superior to inferior technique in a cadaveric multidirectional instability model. The medial to lateral closure technique more closely restores normal motion, but the findings of Harriman and others could not be confirmed despite using a similar interval closure orientation. It is apparent that traditional arthroscopic rotator interval closure techniques have not to date successfully reproduced the biomechanical results of open imbrication. Biomechanical data most reproducibly supports a decrease in anterior glenohumeral translation after arthroscopic rotator interval closure. Its value in decreasing posterior or inferior glenohumeral translation is less well established. The benefit of rotator interval closure should be weighed against its clinically and biomechanically described potential to limit external rotation. If closure is performed, several tips may help maximize its efficacy. As described by Gartzman and others, tensioning the closure in 30 degrees of external rotation should minimize external rotation contractures. In addition, by placing the medial stitch 3 to 4 millimeters from the glenoid and tying each stitch extracapsularly helps to capture the maximal amount of tissue, making the closure as robust as possible. Additional stitches may also be placed more laterally as necessary to achieve the desired closure magnitude. A rotator interval closure may be performed in either a beach chair or lateral decubitus position. Here, the rotator interval is visualized from the posterior portal in a left shoulder of a patient with multidirectional shoulder instability. A patulous and thin anterior capsule is visualized. A spinal needle is used to approximate a standard anterior arthroscopic portal through the rotator interval. Next, the arm is externally rotated approximately 30 degrees to minimize external rotation contractures, and a cannula is positioned just outside the joint capsule. A shuttling device is then passed through the cannula, penetrating the middle glenohumeral ligament just superior to the subscapularis and about 3 to 4 millimeters lateral to the glenoid as visualized here. A suture is then advanced into the joint. The cannula is redirected superiorly and a penetrating instrument is passed anterior to the supraspinatus tendon through the superior glenohumeral ligament base. The previously passed suture is then retrieved through the same cannula in the anterior portal. The suture is then used to shuttle a non-absorbable stitch through the same tissue. Next, a crochet hook is used to retrieve the suture limbs into the anterior cannula to avoid inadvertently capturing deltoid tissue. The sutures are tied extra-articularly, thereby capturing as much capsular tissue as possible. Additionally, sutures are placed laterally as necessary to accomplish the desired closure magnitude. Typically, two sutures are used, although in more severe cases, three can be placed. The final rotator interval closure is seen here in addition to the completed anterior capsulorraphy. Postoperative rehabilitation is dependent on concomitant pathology, but protocols are similar whether an open or arthroscopic technique is used. Protocols should be individualized to each patient based on the direction of primary instability and the repair robustness. Typically, a shoulder immobilizer with an abduction pillow in approximately neutral rotation is used for 4 to 6 weeks. Ad lib elbow, wrist, and hand motion is allowed immediately postoperatively. It is our experience that patients with multidirectional instability rarely have difficulty regaining motion. Therefore, we prefer, in this population, to immobilize the shoulder for at least 4 weeks. Therapy should be initiated if the shoulder becomes stiff. However, if the glenohumeral joint remains supple, longer periods of immobilization may be necessary. After the immobilizer is discontinued, patients are progressed through active motion to strengthening exercises around 6 weeks. Though individualized by patient, full activities are allowed around 6 months postoperatively if they're able to demonstrate full strength and have completed a sport-specific training program.